Hey, Mr. Kiss, for this thing in working fast, man. It's all right, I have the written card copy right here. We're going to have Mrs. Williams give us a presentation of the Marine Boot Camp experience.
Yes. Good evening, my name is Gloria Williams, for those of you that don't know me, and I teach at Rochester High School. We have a recruiter from the Marine Corps, his name is Sergeant Jeffries, who's stationed out of Kokomo, and he comes to Rochester High School several times a year. One time he was there back in October, November, and he invited Mr. Strasser to send out an email asking for teachers to volunteer to apply to attend the Marine Corps Educator Workshop in San Diego. This is something that I wanted to do because this is an area that I am not very familiar with the military, and I felt like that was a way I could grow as an educator to come back and give back to our students and give them that experience. So I applied, as well as Mrs. Hinderleiter. She also went, and we went the last week of January. The Marine Corps paid for all expenses. They paid for our flight, our hotel, our food. They gave us a daily stipend, and they gave us an amazing week of workshop. I hope that I represented Rochester very well. I worked very hard prior to this so that I was not hyperventilating as I was running or doing any of the exercises. So I felt like I was really working towards a goal, both personally and professionally, to go out and represent, take everything I could back. So I have a couple things to share. The first one is something that the Marine Corps out of Indianapolis put together. It's like a video of our week in like 2 minutes, and then I have a PowerPoint to show you. Hopefully this works. If it doesn't, it's okay. I can go through my PowerPoint. This is just something additional that they kind of threw together. It's a really cool video. Mr. Kistler, it's okay.
What would you prefer, Lori? Would you rather go with the video or would you rather just go with PowerPoint?
We can do PowerPoint. It's more personal. The video, just a 2 minute clip where they just summarize the whole week, but I feel like I did a pretty good job summarizing that here for us, so I think we'll be okay. So the purpose of the Educators Workshop is to take us from start to finish for the 13 weeks of boot camp, give us exposure to all aspects of what boot camp is like. And then they want us to come back and talk to our students and teach them about honor, courage, and commitment, and try to not necessarily recruit for them, but help them to identify students that would be a good fit for this. I am no means of an expert, but I felt like I have enough knowledge that I could speak to kids and talk to them. Matter of fact, we had one young man who was thinking about military. I went through my PowerPoint with him, and he has signed and enlisted, so he will be going to boot camp in September out in California. So that was a really cool experience for me to share that with him, and now he's made that decision. So you can go ahead. So we were the students. These were our directors. We have Sergeant Jeffries from the Kokomo region. He's on the far left. He's the one that comes to our high school. We had the Fort Wayne recruiter with us. We had the Indianapolis region recruiter with us. Major Harley was he is the overall Indiana recruiting commanding officer. We had Captain Ashmore, he was in charge of the Western region. And then all the way to the right, that was our senior drill instructor, Staff Sergeant Evans. And he actually is from Kokomo, Indiana. So that was a great connection that we got to make with him. And the 30 educators that attended from Indiana, our goal was to always make him try to laugh or smile because he doesn't get to do that very much. So that was our goal. So here's just a quick overview of what we did. On Sunday, we went down to Indianapolis and we got to meet our Indiana platoon. We got to meet all of the recruiters that were traveling with us. Monday was a travel day. We got to do a welcome aboard dinner, meet the people that would be in charge with us or our chaperones. Tuesday, we spent the day at Marine Corps Recruiting Depot and receiving, which is right butting up next to the airport in San Diego. So it was, there were many times where it was hard to hear. I mean, but they're used to yelling really, really loud. So we had no problems there. Wednesday, we were at Marine Corps Air Station Miramar. We got to play a little Top Gun and see the aircraft. Thursday, we were at Camp Pendleton. And then Friday, we were able to witness the graduation ceremony, a change of color ceremony, and then we traveled home late that night. So, you can go ahead. So pretty much the entire time we were gone, we were up by 5, had to be in formation at 6 a.m., and then we were off to whatever we were doing, and then we weren't back until like 6 p.m. So it was a very, very cram-packed week. These are the educators that attended with us. From all over, from we've got administrators, counselors, teachers, and we had two ladies from the radio station 92.5 in Kokomo that went and broadcasted live for our week, just for secondary educators. This is the, he's the senior drill instructor for the St. Louis platoon that was there. So we have lots of competitions between St. Louis and Indiana, but he's also from the region up north, and he really liked to connect with us back home as well. Okay, so Tuesday we started out, and they wanted us to get the full experience of what the first 15 minutes of boot camp entailed.
Oh boy.
So from the time they picked us up at the hotel, we learned formation, and we basically said, aye, sir, yes, sir, no, sir. Those were the only things that we were basically saying in response to our senior drill instructor. And he put us on the bus and he said, okay, I'm gonna give you the full experience. You're gonna sit here, you're gonna put your head down, and you're not gonna talk. We're like, we're on the bus. No, you're gonna put your head down. So we did. We get there, and we're all kind of just like, what is going on? And a different senior drill instructor gets on the bus and starts yelling, screaming,
oh, yeah.
You are now on MCRD, blah, 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 you know, very intense. And then he said, now get off my bus. So we run off the bus and we get information on the yellow footprints. So that's where that senior drill instructor is teaching us how to stand with our hands, put your hands up, put your hands down, put your stuff up, put your stuff down, you're not going fast enough. And just very intense. They gave us some rules, like there's a big board on the outside, you'll see a picture of that. They read that very quickly, very loudly, told us to get to the left. We ran inside to the contraband room. Inside the contraband room are the little stalls where the soldiers would come in. They would put all their stuff, if they had anything, which they don't bring much. The recruits, excuse me, not soldiers. I really hope I don't mess anything up in a thing. I'm nervous because he's sitting right there. So then, in the contraband room, they go over the rules and they issue them their gear, and then they do a moment of truth. It's like the last minute, you better not, you know, leave anything out, what do we need to know? And then they get to make that phone call home, which I'll show you in a minute, which is really hard. Then we sat through about 3 hours of classroom briefings where we learned a lot of educational things, numbers, data, met some pretty interesting people there. And then we went, through a mock Black Friday. Mrs. Vance, that is not shopping. There were no shoes involved. At this point in time, the recruits come in late on a Monday night. So they fly in about 11 o'clock-ish. And when they come to MCRD, it's dark, but they still have their heads down. They get off the bus. They're going through all of this late in the evening time. And then Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday, they still are not with their senior drill instructor yet. They still have not met that person. They're just going through paperwork and routine. So then on Friday, they call that Black Friday for them. That is where they meet their senior drill instructor and the two assisting drill instructors that they will be paired with for the 12 weeks of boot camp. So we got to actually participate in one crazy adrenaline rush, all those kind of things happen during that. And I'll have a little preview for you of that. We got to eat lunch then with the new recruits. So these are recruits that have only been in for 4 weeks. They have yet to talk to a civilian. They've only said yes sir, aye aye sir, no sir. So when we sat down, it was like, well, tell us about your experience. And they just didn't even know what to say because they had not been able to see or talk. Mrs. Hinderleiter, who I'm with, says she gets all sappy because the boy decided on Christmas to not call his mom, but called the girlfriend. So Mrs. Hinderleiter goes to our senior drill instructor and says, excuse me, I think I need to give this phone to this recruit right here, and he needs to call his mama and say, Merry Christmas, I'm sorry, I did not call you. And the senior drill instructor, he's like, no, ma'am, they get no phone calls. And the recruits in the background were, no, 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 like, I don't want to get in trouble, no.
Right.
So that was a really cool experience to eat lunch with them. We watched a swim demonstration where they have 1 whole week at swim, which we'll talk about that later. We got to watch a martial arts demonstration. Then we ourselves participated in the obstacle course. I finished, she finished. It was an experience. And we walked in formation to the Walker Hall tour where their physical therapy department is. So if any recruits are injured, they go to this area for the short time until they're healed so they can go back. And then we did the combat fitness test. So here's the sign that's hanging outside the yellow footprints. That was a posed picture, I promise. We were not doing that as we were being yelled at. We went back after and took our picture. So on the left-hand side, this is inside the contraband room. And then on the right-hand side, this is the last phone call. So they have less than 30 seconds to make this phone call. They're not allowed to have conversation. They have to read this as fast as they can. So, hello, this is Recruit Williams. I've arrived safely at MCRD San Diego. The next time I contact you will be postal mail, so expect a letter in 2 to 3 weeks. I love you, goodbye. And they hang up that phone. So for all of us, we had chills over that because that made it very real. So on the left-hand side, we visited a squad bay. There's one bunk closest to us that did not have a top, and that was for the platoon leader. And we kind of got to walk around there. I won't take very long to show you the video, but on the right-hand side, this is what happens when the recruits are coming to meet their senior staff recruiter. Drill sergeant, excuse me. If it doesn't work, it's okay. I promise everything works at school, so go ahead. So anyhow, they come out, they slam the door, and they just start in right away. So very intense. Swim demo again, they have a week of swimming, and the goal is to learn how to make flotation devices out of their camis and their pants and their shoes. So in this example, the gentleman had taken off his trousers, he had tied the ends together of the feet, and then he had taken the waist, opened it up, and was swishing water and building that oxygen, and then closed that and wrapped it around his neck as a flotation device. So a couple different things that they showed us, jumping off, swimming. They were, there were a couple guys in the water that were, combative with each other and showing us what they're trained to do in that aspect. So this is just one more component that we talked about. Here's the obstacle course. Again, we started at the small tubes there on the bottom, so we had to jump over those. They didn't want us to do anything extremely high, so like we didn't climb the rope, and we didn't climb up to those long ones, but we had to low crawl. Oh, we said army crawl, and they're like, do not say that for me! Okay, so we low crawled underneath those. The wall was about 6 foot tall. We went over the wall, and so we got to experience that. That was really fun. And then the combat fitness test. We had a 880 meter run, and then we had ammo cans that weighed about 30 pounds that we had to lift from chest over our head. We had to do 40 of those in 2 minutes. And then the maneuver under fire, lots of different things. We had a low crawl, a high crawl, a slalom. We had push-ups. We had to run with ammo cans. We had to do a buddy crawl, a fireman's carry, throw a grenade, and then run back. So that was a combination of what we had to do, and we did it in 2 minutes and 35 seconds, and I think 2 minutes is the cut time for women. So there were 4 women that tagged up to do this, you know, just for fun, but we did pretty well with that. So at that point in time, that was our Tuesday. Very cool experience there. Wednesday, we went to Marine Corps Air Station Miramar. We got to talk to some junior enlisted Marines who were in their first 4 years, talking about what their plan was, what education was offered to them. They are 150% pro-education. It was like we were royalty to them just for what we do, and that was just a huge honor in itself. We got to watch a staff sergeant become a gunnery sergeant, promotion ceremony at Miramar. Then we went to the education center, and they offer, you name it, they offer it. They've got really nice stuff for the recruits to come and work on their education programs. We went to the flight line, as you can see. We got to see the Marine Corps band perform, just a small one. They entertained during lunch. We were able to talk to the chaplain, who happens to be in the Navy, but he services both. And then we did a career Marine panel of people that were getting ready to retire. So the gentleman that started talking, he said his name, and then he said, I'm 37 and I retired in a year and a half. And I'm like, really? A year and a half and he's gonna retire? He might retire in like 30 years. But he was very excited about that, and two single moms putting themselves through the Marines. So just a great, great career panel that we got to listen to. And then we attended the museum on MCRD. On the left-hand side is the Marine Corps band performing at graduation ceremony. On the right-hand side, if we had sound, it would be a little video of what they played. I mean, these guys were fabulous musicians, and so we had the opportunity to listen to them a couple times. Thursday, by far my best experience at Camp Pendleton. For those of you that don't know, Camp Pendleton is where they finish their last stages. So week 12, they are at Camp Pendleton doing the crucible, which we'll talk about in a moment. We participated in what's called 12 stalls. There's like 12 kind of brain teaser puzzles that you pair up with 7 other people and you participate in there. We had 2 hours at 12 stalls and we got to do the different activities. A warrior's breakfast, which I'll talk about in a moment. Circles, we learned how to hold an M16, the safety of an M16, and how to aim. And then we went through a safety briefing where we had to very quickly and loudly repeat the rules back to our senior staff, our senior drill instructor. Then we participated in live fire. So we all got to shoot 20 rounds of ammo with the M16. And the competence course, so you can see I'm on the competence course right now. There were several different stages of that. And this one's all about core by the time you get done with it, because the ropes start out pretty good, but then they get shorter and shorter and shorter. And so you're ducked down trying to crawl, and it's fun. It's good. And then we did an education briefing where we got a little bit more information about a leadership conference, which I've signed up a couple of our students to try to attend. Nothing Marine-based, but the Marine puts it on out in Washington. So we had a great, great end of that day. Top hand, top left corner, you can see some of the safety briefing rules. The middle picture and the top right, those were all the 12 stalls. So you can see our group was participating there in the middle. We tried to get that gasoline can over to the other side. You couldn't touch the mulch and you couldn't touch anything red or you died. So if you died, you had to take a buddy and you had to go run with ammo cans. So we definitely died a couple times. We did that run. And then on the bottom, we were at the circles figuring out our aim. And then on the bottom right, that was half of the company. So that was 3 platoons coming to the Warriors breakfast. So company Bravo ended up graduating on Friday when we were there. They have 6 platoons, and there's about 140 to 160 recruits in each platoon. So the crucible, this has my heart now. This is pretty intense. They have 54 hours to complete the crucible. It is a mock war scene. They receive 3 MREs, which is their meals. They have to learn to ration. after lunch to share. They get 4 hours of sleep each night, so the two nights. They have to do the 12 stalls that you just saw. They have to participate in an IED course. We'll come back to the Reaper. They have to do the confidence course. They're in the gas chamber for, and while they're in the gas chamber, the drill instructors are messing with them. And that time is just for them to gain the confidence in their equipment. They want them to understand that if you're in this situation, your equipment is going to get you through. And then overall, 20 kilometers hiking pretty much throughout the Crucible in those 54 hours. The Reaper is what you see here. So it's like a mini mountain. They climb to the top. When they get to the top, they are officially declared a Marine. We had our radio station go at 4 o'clock in the morning as the sun was rising so that they could experience this and share this with us. If you ever get the opportunity to Google the Reaper and watch these gentlemen receive their pin, their Global Eagle Anchor, if I said that out of order, I apologize to any of you that know, but they receive that pin, they're officially declared a Marine. They come down that hill, they get 1 hour, I can get emotional, they get 1 hour to shower, get in formation, and walk to chow. We got to experience what's called the Warrior's Breakfast with them. So they come in, they get as much food as they want. Steak, eggs, cake, fruit, you name it, they get it. And these recruits, I mean, their trays were piled. It didn't matter. Their cake was somewhere in the middle of that stuff, but that tray was full. And we sat down with them, and, you know, I introduced myself, and I said, please eat. We will talk when you're done eating. And they said, no, ma'am, we would rather talk to you. Like, what? Come at 8, you have all this food. So they started talking to us. They hadn't talked to anybody in 13 weeks at the beginning. And then one boy chimes up and he says, excuse me, ma'am, could you tell me the date? So I told him the date. He goes, oh, yesterday was my 21st birthday. So that made me emotional too, just because, you know, I think our kids here, I think they take those things for granted because they didn't even know. We had a fabulous meal with those recruits, some of the nicest gentlemen that I've ever come across. And they finish, they get in formation, they go back, they have things to finalize at Camp Pendleton, then the last week they go back. So, and then finally we ended our Friday morning. We got to watch the morning color ceremony, we got to watch graduation, and we got a certificate of completion. So. I just want to thank you guys. I want to thank Mr. Strasser. I had a fabulous sub. I had no worries back here, but this was probably one of the most rewarding experiences I'll ever have in education, I think. So I appreciate you allowing me to go. If you knew about it, I went, and it was a blast.
Well, thank you, Lori and Leah, for going. And on that note, Skeeter, you were you never say former Marine, you're prior active duty Marine, correct?
Former Marine,
and then Paul, I know you were in the military, the Army, Paul Tinsman, and then Jason, you were in the military and the Army, right? Any other service members here that Scott? You were in?
Army.
And Army. We're in Army. Thank you all for your service. Did I miss anybody? Because I certainly don't want to forget that. Thank you. After that, it's kind of hard to go on to consent items, but go on so to consent items, certification of the January 13th executive session. Any addendums or subtractions from that? In that case, is there a motion to approve those minutes?
Do you want to do all the consent items at once, or do you want us to do them each
individually? Can we do all the consent items at once?
Yeah.
Okay. January. Okay. Let me start over then. January meeting, regular board. February 1st study session. February 1st special board meeting. February 13th special board meeting and public hearing. And that was all of them, I believe. Is there any comments, critiques, additions, or subtractions from that? In that case, I'll take a motion to approve those minutes.
So moved.
So moved by Jenny.
Second.
Second by Sandy. All in favor of approving minutes, raise your right hand. Motion carries. You had it up, right? 7-0. Move on to the financial report.
So we've got, and I apologize, on the claims docket, it does say,
$10,823 to $10,491. That's actually a correction. The $10,491 should be $10,960. So I apologize for that error, but we'll make sure it gets identified correctly in the minutes. So those claims docket totals $1,290,691. And then we have a couple payrolls to approve as well. Excuse me. Roads. We've got the February 3rd payroll that was in the amount of $402,852.90. And then we have the February 17th payroll in the amount of $418,389.74. And then on the funds report that is provided as well, we've got general fund that started out at $575,779.99. We had $1,018,483.73 worth of receipts. Month-to-date expenses totaled $866,102.47, leaving an ending balance of $728,061.25 to general fund for the month of January. Our debt service fund started with $1,842,291.96. We had some property tax revenue credits in the amount of $4,205.44. I used for debt service, capital projects fund, our transportation and bus replacement. We get these dollars every month from January to December. Our 1782 budget notice has not been made available yet, so I did use 2016 rates until we get them in 17, and then I'll make sure that the 17 rates are applied correctly from there. So debt service received $4,205.44 worth of receipts. No expenditures for the month, leaving an ending balance of $1,846,497.40 for debt service. Capital projects fund started with $820,137.51. We had $4,514.42 worth of receipts. Expenses for the month totaled to $175,309.62, leaving an ending balance of $649,342.31 in capital projects. Transportation fund started with $1,121,508.04, had $4,405.44 worth of receipts. Expenses for the month totaled $35,610.69, leaving an ending balance of $1,090,302.79. And bus replacement, we started with $237,964.10, $4,205.43 worth of receipts. No expenses for the month, so that ending balance comes to $242,169.53 for bus replacement. Any questions?
Any additions, subtractions, questions? Is there a motion to approve the financial reports, approval of claims, and funds reports and payroll?
So moved.
Moved by Sandy.
Second.
Second by Tom. All in favor of approving the prior said, raise your right hand. All motion carries 7-0. Moving on to student and stakeholder focus donations. Let's see here. Number one, and I'm going to say this beforehand, I'm going to say it after, because we can never say thank you enough to all those who donate. We so sincerely appreciate it. Thank you, thank you, thank you. It's really appreciated by us as a board and the teachers and the students. So thank you, and I will say that again at the end. Do not let me forget. This first donation to be approved is Rochester Lodge for the RHS Manitowals, the amount of $100. Kyle and Lori Hoover for the RHS Manitowals, $16. Top Motorsports to RHS Athletics, $250. Fraunfelter Family Dentistry to Columbia, toothbrushes with the family logo. Psi Iota Z RHS reading counts, $50. Psi Iota Z RMS reading counts, $50. Psi Iota Z Riddle reading counts, $50. And Psi Iota Z Columbia reading counts, $50. Did I pronounce that correctly?
Yes.
Zai, is it Zai? Okay, need to work on my Greek then, don't I?
It should be Trike.
Trike, I'm not getting any. Where's my Coke at, so I can't say anything. Are there any questions or deletions or additions to the donations? Is there a motion to approve these donations as presented?
I move that we approve the donations as presented.
Motion by Steve, second by Rick. All in favor, raise your right hand. Motion carries 7-0. Faculty and staff focus, the personnel report, which I do have to pull that up. Steve's already on it for me. Thank you, Mr. Vice President. I read it. For...
It's a good vice president.
Hidney, though. He's got a lot of work with me here. With that, starting off, first would be maternity leave. Megan Gongwer, Columbia second grade teacher, 2017-18 school year. Do I need to read through all these or just need to read the names, Ted? Family medical leave, James Kessler, bus driver. Nicole Smiley, head building technician at Columbia. Resignations, Amy Ollinger at Riddle Food Service Manager. Sports resignations, Tony Stasiak, head girls basketball coach. And approving teachers for the spring intersession, Leslie Strim at Riddle, Angie Smith, Megan Schroeder, both of those at Riddle. Bethany Sewell and Megan Gongwer, Columbia second grade and Columbia first grade respectively. And Cassie Boggs Kinder at Columbia Kindergarten. Emily Brown is at Columbia IA. Linda Arnett at RMS, Tammy Paul at RMS, Ken Hughes at RMS, Alan Sager at RMS. And this is updated March 20th, or should that be February 20th?
I updated it today.
Okay. Hiring Todd Wilson as a substitute for Kayla Seacrest maternity leave. Sarah Reese is a substitute for Kelly Scheidler's maternity leave. Jamie Bach is resigning as the high school ECA treasurer. And for spring intercession, Tracy Monaco at Riddle instructional assistant, Felix Amandi at high school English, and Deb Wolford for RHS mathematics. Are there any additions, deletions, or questions on the personnel report?
I think that last should have brought it up to date.
Any questions from the board? What? In that case, is there a motion to approve the personnel report?
So.
Rick moved to approve the personnel report. Stacy second. All in favor of approving the personnel report, please raise your right hand. Motion carries 7-0. Transportation extracurricular activity pay increase.
If you look in your board documents, there is a two-page handout there that the transportation department brought to both Val and myself in regards to ECAs. Those are all of those extracurricular trips when they take the students to basketball games or those wrestling tournaments on Saturday. Can include field trips when we have multiple buses going out during the school day. The current rate that we are paying is $13.10 for the first hour. We've got this all broken down there in your notes. 8.26 for hours 2 through 8, 12.54 for anything over 9 hours. They are proposing just a slight increase there for the first hour to $13.50, $10 an hour for those second through 8 hours, $15 for 9 or more hours. We gave examples of what that might look like. Bless Val's heart, she's always on top of this for me. When we were starting to break down those numbers, we did contact other school districts around the area to make sure that our numbers were comparable to what other schools were offering their drivers, knowing also that across the state, transportation bus drivers, there is a huge shortage. It's a job that's in demand right now. So on page 2, it gives a more defined proposed ECA pay increase and what that might look like. We took all of the 2015-2016 ECA trips as a comparative, broke that up into what that would look like on the new pay scale, and the additional costs would run right at that $5,000 mark, something that our transportation department can easily handle, both Val and I felt, but also would be giving to the bus drivers what they're asking in regards to that pay increase, and also bring us more equitable to local districts surrounding us in regards to ECA trips. So I would request that you consider that approval to become effective beginning tomorrow with any ECA trips that go out.
Any questions from the board for Jana? Public? In that case, I will, is there any motion to accept the transportation ECA pay increase?
So moved.
Moved by Sandy?
Second that.
Second by Steve. All in favor of the transportation ECA pay increase, please raise your right hand. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Motion carries 7-0. And I said I would come back this, you didn't remind me. Thank you again for the donations. I know that's on the list, but I want to get that. It's very, very important, and I did not want to keep my word on that.
It is a huge part of what we do. We couldn't do it without those.
Moving on to the updated job description for the transportation director.
With the opening, we always want to go back and make sure that our job description is in alignment with what the current department is doing and what those expectations are. I did meet with Brenda Troyer. I met with Val. Skeeter was part of that. Kevin from the transportation was part of that. I'm sorry, Kim Long, the head secretary, Bill Hamill was part of that committee from the transportation department. We really went through and dissected our former job description. We wanted to bring it comparative to what we know that department needs right now as we have this opening. Part of what I was concerned about was also including a rubric for evaluation moving forward in that position. And so the new job description would also include the rubric that you see presented. I don't know that it needs approved so much as for informational purposes that at this point, I believe with that job description, and I want to thank everybody that helped sit down. We worked on that for a couple of hours one morning, and it was a really good conversation that with that new job description, we would like to go ahead and post that position and begin moving forward with a new transportation director.
Very well, so that means needs no action, correct?
Right, that'll become part of the administrative guidelines for job descriptions for personnel bulletin.
And it seems, and I want to put this out there for public too, we go through a lot of these things somewhat quickly, but a lot of these times, and most times, not all times, we study them in study session, we look at them on our own time before we come to these. So when we're here, we're, I hate to say I'm well educated on them, but at least I have an idea what's going on. So next would be the updated, we've already done that one. Superintendent's business.
Just feel like there's a lot going on that I want to thank people for, but also make sure that the public is aware of and invite them in for a couple of different things. First of all, to Scott Kessler, to Jenny Smith, to Sandy Tyler as board members serving on the tech committee. We had a couple of different entities come in. I think that those were good discussions. I know that most teachers and administrators have shared the desire to have deeper training within the technology, making sure that we're integrating that the way that we need to. So just want to thank you for the time spent. There were a lot of after hours conversations that took place and a lot of dedication on many, many people's parts to come in and start looking at that technology. Our Apple lease agreement comes up in March, April. And so it's a decision that we're going to be fine-tuning and then bringing to the board with those teachers' voice and input, as well as Scott and some board members that took the time to serve on that. Part of that technology is that there's been a lot of talk around zSpace. We had them in one time prior. We have invited them back this Wednesday. We most certainly want to invite the public right here to the Learning Center and to this boardroom from 1 until 2:30. I've sent out some personal emails and invitations to some community members, but want to open that up to anybody who may be interested in coming and seeing that. I want to make sure that as we look at that, that's something that could help provide educational opportunities for our students that can immediately take them out into the workforce. And I think the ones best to answer that are those in our community that are currently out in the workforce. So a sincere invitation to come in this Wednesday here in this boardroom from 1 until 2:30 and provide that open, honest feedback around that technology. We actually have teachers coming in the morning to look at that again. Then part of what we've been doing this month is the Kiwanis is the service group. We have invited them into our building on different occasions. They will be here to provide their voice and their input in that as well and see that firsthand, but really want to hear from the community before we make those large decisions around that.
Emphasis on please, please, please come to these things and let us know what your thoughts are and see them. It's not just a, let's say it for the camera. We want the public's input, and sometimes surveys is an anonymous.
Absolutely.
So we'd rather see if you can. I know it's tough because people work and it's 1 to 2:30, but if you can, please come to these things. Give us your input.
And I've also shared in the email and invitations, if those times don't work, please just let us know, because we actually have them here for the majority of the day Wednesday, and we have different modules and different units here. And so if those times don't work, just please let me know and we'll do all we can to find a time that will work. Just to touch on calendar makeup, I don't want to jinx the weather as we've had the 60-degree February weather, and there was some push from the administrative team that they thought maybe we should call a fair weather day in the middle of February instead of a, and I don't know that I would have had much pushback. But
it's funny, the post today, we're worried we didn't get a 2-hour fog alert.
So right now we have 3 days that we need to make up. So today was our first day as a makeup day. We will be in session on April 7th as a makeup day. And as it stands, May 30th, right after Memorial Day, will be our last makeup day as well as the last day of school. I know that's hard to come back that one day afterwards, but knock on wood, if we don't need any more, we should be done on May 30th at this point in time, weather permitting.
And on that note, there was a rumor going around, we'll have to do this, we'll have to do that. Before we have to do that, we still have the 30th we have to do, correct?
We have.
And then it would go, what, e-learning?
Then it would be May 31st.
So we still have another day built in.
In the calendar. So we would exhaust 4 makeup days that were approved. And then we would have, we agreed on 3 e-learning days. And then from there, we could take from spring intercession if we needed to.
But that is our last resort. That was
absolutely
the rumor, and I want to make sure we clarify
absolutely
that, not putting you
no
on the spot.
We so still have e-learning days. We still have one more makeup day. So, and I don't know, boys basketball always, that sectional time always brings around some type of storm and weather, but we're going to bank on getting through this with just those days that we've already missed. And just a sincere thank you. We alluded to it with ECA pay, and I thank you for that approval and the transportation. They've really stepped up. We've had a shortage of drivers with illness, with some changes that we're making, those types of things. And they have really rallied, including Dana over at the high school and Justin Pearson picking up some routes for us, and everybody's really stepped up. So it's been a great opportunity to see that department really rally together and start to make some changes for the betterment of student and transportation. So I do want to take the time to thank them. And I think that's all I have.
On that note, board members, anything publicly, any comments or questions? Rick?
Yes,
Stacy?
Yeah.
Tom? Steve? Sandy? Jenny? At the end of every board meeting, we give the public the opportunity to speak. If anybody has anything to say, welcome to now. In that case, with no further business, I'll adjourn the meeting.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone, for attending.